This edition of the interview, we're going to go back a little bit in time to Hollywood life and career, talking with the man you see before you, John Farr, who has a website called Best Movies by Farr. And after we get talking of the life and career of Bogey, we will talk with John Farr about his life and career in cinema and cinema criticism. And that'll be coming up next. Well, John Farr, I want to welcome you to this edition. And for those people who may not have heard of your website, Best Movies by Farr, why don't you tell a little bit about who you are, what the website's about, and we'll get into it a little bit deeper, but just a brief introduction, and then we'll talk about the life and career of Humphrey Bogart.
Okay, thanks, Dan. Well, the idea for the website started actually a while back when video stores were the big thing. And you'd get a call from your significant other on a Friday afternoon saying, on your way home, get a video, will you? Because we're going to watch something tonight. We're just going to stay in. And you'd walk into Blockbuster. Remember Blockbuster?
Yeah.
And you'd have this sea of titles. And you really didn't have much of a clue as to what to get. That I would take all the best streaming and put them in one place to be sort of a quick filter to help people who wanted to watch a great movie find that great movie quicker.
So is your website basically the equivalent of a Hulu Netflix, or is it, or what?
Well, the Hulu and Netflix are terrific, but they're not really curated by a human being. They're curated by algorithms. And I think we all had the experience of being on either on Netflix or Amazon or Hulu and sort of realizing that some of the things that are being recommended to you based on your, you know, past viewing experiences are not necessarily great movies. And I do this all the time. I'm basically saying, oh, well, what's that? And I go on IMDb or I do my own check and see that it's, you know, got a 6.1 rating. And I'm like, why are they recommending this to me? The fact is that they have a ton of titles that they have to push out. So there isn't the quality curation that we offer on Best Movies by Farr. We're like a consumer advocate, if you will, for great movies.
Okay, so basically you don't host the movies. You're not like Netflix where people, or there's a movie called Fandor that has like a lot of popular foreign films. You're not hosting the movies yourself. You're basically just giving recommendations.
But importantly, we do offer one-click access to stream these movies. So it's just one click away from Netflix or Hulu or Amazon.
I would assume then you have some kind of like deal, like however many people come through your portal, you get some money from these organizations.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, let's turn to the man. That was the reason for doing this show, Humphrey Bogart, because I know one of the things that I found interesting about your site vis-a-vis a lot of other movie websites that I've seen is that, off the top of my head, at least 25% to maybe a third of your films seem to be from the classic era of Hollywood rather than just the latest big blockbuster. And in that vein, a lot of them are the old black and white Hollywood classics, also some foreign films. And Humphrey Bogart himself, again, I think he was voted the AFI's greatest star of the 20th century 10-15 years ago when they were doing all those millennial lists. So let's talk a little bit about Bogart. How did you become a Bogart fan? Or did you grow up on it? Or was he your favorite star, your favorite tough guy when you were growing up?
Yeah, he was one of them.
Yeah.
Basically, I was one of those kids who I grew up in New York City, just like Bogey.
Yeah.
And I went to private school, just like Bogey. And in fact, he went to Trinity School and I went to Browning, and they were sort of competitive schools. I didn't know any of that at the time, but I would come back from school when I was, 8-10 years old, and I would turn on what was then called the 4:30 movie in New York City. And I would watch, Cagney, Bogart, Spencer G's stars in these amazing movies. So my grounding in film was in the class era of Hollywood.
Yeah.
You had these amazing stars, and you had great stories and great scripts. And that's how I discovered Bogart.
Yeah, I know when you mentioned that, I remember the 4:30 movie when I was a kid growing up in the 70s. And then I remember there was also the Million Dollar Movie on Channel 9, WOR.
Which had the Era theme from Gone with the Wind.
Right, and then I also remember late night there was a Creature Feature with like a six-fingered clay hand. That was Chiller Theater was the six-fingered clay hand, and then Creature Feature had mostly all the Universal old stuff. So yes, yeah, I remember as a kid growing up.
The mask in the beginning that turned different colors. It was we were watching all the same stuff, Dan.
Yeah.
But those movies, those classics, be they from MGM or Warner Brothers, where Bogart spent most of his career, formed me. And then later on, when I learned about the story of Bogart, his life trajectory, it's even more fascinating and compelling that he actually became probably the biggest movie icon of the past century.
Yeah, well, according to AFI, that's correct. So let's talk a little bit about, you said he came from wealth and whatnot, and he was born, in 1899.
Yep.
Just looking at some online information, he didn't turn to acting, though, it seems, until after World War One, and he actually was on the stage. I mean, he wasn't in the silent era. He didn't hit the movies until about a decade later. So
right.
he was basically a decade on Broadway.
Yeah, he was, and basically, I think he turned to acting. Well, one, he used to do plays up in the Finger Lake region. His family had a beautiful house up in the Finger Lakes, and as a kid, they would put on the little theatricals, and he enjoyed that.
Yeah.
But I also think he came to acting because there wasn't much else for him to do. He was an abysmal student. He was sent to Trinity School. He did not do well. They then sent him to Phillips and Andover, which is a very prestigious prep school in the East, and he failed there. I think he was expelled. I think they even managed to get him into Yale for about 10 minutes before he was expelled. He always had an issue with authority and convention. He was not particularly interested in his studies, although he was extremely bright. He just wasn't a student. So he'd always also loved the water. So frankly, World War One saved him because he got into the Navy. But when he got out with an honorable discharge in 1919, he didn't really know what to do. He had a couple of jobs, sort of starting out, sales jobs and things like that. And then he got an opportunity with a gentleman named William Brady, who was a Broadway producer. And the Brady family really launched him, and he had about a decade on Broadway. Just a trivia note, Alice Brady, who was the daughter who knew Bogey well from those early days, played the Daffy mother in one of my favorite screwball comedies from the 30s, My Man Godfrey.
It was
her father who were the ones who got Bogey launched.
Well, so that was his acting career. How did he transition over into the film side? Did he just light out to Hollywood? Because he came after the sound era had launched.
Yeah, he did. I mean, basically, that was a completely economic decision. The Great Depression happened in 1929, and all of a sudden, they seem to be growing. That's the picture business. You know, packed his band suit and went out to Hollywood. And one of his first pictures, in fact, his only picture with his great friend Spencer Tracy, who maybe is one of my favorite actors of all time,
yeah.
Was a movie called Up the River, 1930. But I should also mention that the amazing thing about Bogart was that, you know, he was from this very privileged background, and he'd started his career on the stage playing sort of these preppy characters, and He used to call them the white trouser roles. You know, he'd come in with his white, long white trousers saying, "Tennis, anyone?" In these plays. And it was only when he was cast as a heavy, really, in a sense, cast against type in terms of his own upbringing, that he broke through.
Yeah.
So from the very early days in Hollywood, by that time, he was usually playing heavies.
Yeah, I know in the 1930s, I know my dad and I used to, my dad was a big Jimmy Cagney fan, and then later in the 40s, he was a John Garfield fan, any of those. But he didn't particularly like Bogey, because I think my dad, it was something Cagney that he had that pugnacity that at least Bogey really didn't have. There was something always more suave about Bogart. But in every Cagney and Bogart film, I think they did four or five together maybe,
yeah.
Cagney kills Bogart.
Yeah, he does. And that was where, you know, that was the 30s for Bogart. I mean, his big breakthrough happened actually on stage in 1934 with The Petrified Forest.
Right.
Which starred Leslie Howard, and he played Duke Mantee, which was based on Dillinger, John Dillinger. He looked like John Dillinger. Mm. So he was perfect, but he was also so menacing. And then he got signed by Warner Brothers, and the real gift came from Leslie Howard, who said, "You're not going to have Edward G. Robinson playing Duke Mantee. If you want me in that movie, you're going to have Bogart."
Yeah.
And so that was what really put Bogey over the top in that film, which was 1936. And then he played all these parts opposite Cagney, who wore the white hat, and Bogart wore the black hat. And you knew that Cagney was going to kill him in the end. And that was the way it worked. And I think Bogart was well aware that, okay, this is what it's going to be for me. I don't think he necessarily thought that he would ever get to be a star. I think he always thought he would be the villain.
Well, did he, now, back during the studio system, before he became a star, wasn't he loaned out to a few other of the minor studios like Republic and whatnot? Because I don't remember off the top of my head the name of the film, but I do remember him playing sort of an Igor-like mad scientist character. Am I imagining that? I think there was
the truth is that we always romanticize the golden age of Hollywood, but, you know, Bogey would be the first to have admitted that he did a lot of turkeys back in the 30s and things that he just hated. But in those days, under the studio system, you had no choice. You could get loaned out.
Yeah.
You did what you were told. Any script you were given, you had to do. If you said, "I won't do that pile of junk," they could suspend you without pay. Which was usually not an option. So, you know, Bogart did some clinkers for sure, but he really wasn't starring in movies in the 1930s, and he was already well into his 30s. I mean, you've got to remember, Bogey didn't become a star until he was in his 40s, which is pretty amazing considering where he ended up, you know, where he ended up in terms of his prominence.
And the interesting thing, you mentioned Leslie Howard. He was a huge star in the late 20s, early 30s, both on stage and in film then. And yet, if you look back at it, I mean, someone like you or I would recognize the name, but I don't think Leslie Howard was on the list of greatest Hollywood stars, too. So it's kind of ironic that Bogart, who, you know, for the 20th century was considered at least the greatest Hollywood star, if not internationally, got his break because of the good graces and of a guy who is, you know, not too well known today.
Well, that's true. But that part of that is also the fact that Leslie Howard, I think, was a spy, was working for the British during the early days of World War II, and he was killed. So he was, you know, he died in his early 40s. He was basically shot down in a plane in 1942 or 41, 42, and that was it for Leslie Howard. So that didn't help. But he was a star. He was a big star, and most people just remember him as Ashley Wilkes in Gone with the Wind. But he was terrific, and indeed Bogart was always so grateful to him that he named his daughter after Leslie Howard.
That he had. Well, let's take a little break here of a trailer from the new film Petrified Forest. And when we get back, let's talk about the turn of the decade into the 1940s and the handful of films that made Bogart a star originally and then also have perpetuated his legacy. So let's watch that trailer right now and come back in a moment.
Of the American desert lies a forest turned to stone, the Petrified Forest. Grim, silent, mysterious. Here in a lonely desert tavern, fate draws together a strange company. Alan Squire, a vagabond adventurer running away from his past. Gabrielle Maple, a beautiful girl weary of the desert solitude, eager to escape with the first man who comes her way. Bose Hammond, an ex-football hero down on his luck. Paul Chisholm, multimillionaire banker vacationing with his disillusioned young wife, Dorothy. Gramp Maple, a sly old reprobate. And Duke Mantee, vicious leader of a notorious band of gunmen, hiding out after a gang massacre. In the short space of 24 eventful hours, these characters live a lifetime of romance, adventure, terror, and tragedy. It's one of the most unusual stories ever brought to the screen, The Petrified Forest.
Well, if you must know, I'll tell you the extent of my pride. Gabrielle gave me this dollar.
You did.
It's none of your business.
Would you like to know what she was going to give me when those rats showed up? Would you like to know?
Well, speaking of rats, of all the low, slimy, stinky...
Now, Gabrielle, now, you mustn't blame Bose. You must remember, he's a man of muscle. He's suffering from the pangs of frustration.
I said you were a dirty low...
I'm sorry, Gabby. I didn't mean it. Honest, I didn't. They've got me absolutely crazy mad with all those guns staring me in the face.
Shut up, Bose.
Step over to the other side of the room, halfback.
Wouldn't you like someone to be in love with you?
Yes, Gabrielle, I would like someone in love with me.
Do you think I'm attractive?
There are better words than that for what you are.
If I speak up, my dear, perhaps I could tell you some things that...
What do you know about me?
I don't know about you, my dear. But I do know what it means to repress yourself and starve yourself.
What were you saying? I'm telling you for your own good, Mantee. They know where you're heading. They picked up your trail. And they'll get you.
What's the matter with you, Duke? Do something!
Shut up! Shut up!
Give me time to think!
No, Duke. You want revenge, don't you? You want to go out of your way again to get that blonde who snitched. Well, don't do it, Duke.
She has snitched. Come on, Duke!
I told you to shut up. You know they're going to get you anyway. You're obsolete, Duke, like me. You've got to die. Well, then die for freedom. That's worth it. Don't give up your life for anything so cheap and unsatisfactory as revenge. Any woman's worth everything that any man has to give. Anguish, ecstasy, faith, jealousy, love, hatred. Life or death.
Sometimes I feel as if I was sparkling all over, and I want to go out and do something absolutely crazy and marvelous.
Just keep in mind that I and the boys is candidates for hanging. And the first time any one of you makes a wrong move, I'm going to kill a whole lot of you.
We just saw clips from his break film, but Let's talk about the Bogart that is the icon, the Bogart that you know, everyone imitates, the way people imitate John Wayne or Jimmy Cagney or whatnot. And that was really with the turn of the 40s. I mean, he did break through with Petrified Forest, as you mentioned, but then I guess he sort of treaded water for a few more years. What was his first breakthrough film that launched him into the stratosphere?
Well, there were two, I'll say there were three people who really turned him into a star. One was Hal B. Wallace, who was the head of production, who made the decisions. But it was also George Raft, another actor who was almost forgotten today, but was a huge star at Warner Brothers in the late 30s, early 40s. And George Raft was not very bright. And George Raft kept turning down roles that he should have taken. That gave Bogart an opening. One of those movies is called High Sierra, which is one of the last gangster roles that Bogart played up until well into the 50s when he did The Desperate Hours. And that's a fantastic movie that not that many people have seen. But
The High Sierra, if I recall, was sort of like the Duke Mantee, wasn't it?
It was another sort of John Dillinger type character.
Right.
And it has Ida Lupino in it, and it's just a great movie. It's Raoul Walsh was the director.
Yeah.
And that was the beginning, because there Bogart is a gangster, but he's also the star. Uh-huh. But really, it's the Maltese Falcon that everybody thinks of. It's really one of the great detective movies of all time. It's one of the great movies of all time. And it was a movie that Bogart was very proud of, and it did make him a star, a bona fide star, pretty much overnight. But the story of how he got that part is absolutely wonderful. They wanted George Raft. The studio, Warner Brothers, wanted George Raft to play Sam Spade. And Raft said, well, wait a minute. I've got it in my contract that I don't have to do remakes. Well, the Maltese Falcon had been made back in the early 30s. And so he's like, well, I'm not liking that. And, well, who's the director? Well, it's this kid named John Huston. Up to that point, John Huston, who was literally in his late 20s at the time, maybe even younger, had just been a writer, done screenplays. And this was his big chance to direct. And obviously, he was from show business royalty. His father was Walter Huston, who was already a star in Hollywood. And Huston loved Bogey, loved him. I mean, they were best friends. They became best friends over time and collaborated on some amazing films later. But Huston basically went to Hal Wallace and said, you know, Raft doesn't want to do it. Give me Bogey. And Hal Wallace went, Bogey? You know, he's our second banana villain, Bogey. He said, okay, you know, let's do it. And that was it. That was it.
You know, it's interesting. You mentioned George Raft. You had mentioned Leslie Howard being a spy, but George Raft actually, if everyone is to believe, was actually at one point a real-life gangster, too. He was. Yeah. And
I'm sure I can say he was a gangster, but he sure knew a lot of them.
Yeah.
and palled around with them. But boy, did he blow it on his career.
Now, Maltese Falcon was what, 41?
Yeah.
And was there anything between that and Casablanca the next year that sustained the momentum that he got from Maltese Falcon?
I mean, honestly, I don't, no movie between 1941 and 1942 comes to mind between them that, but that's only, you know, they're only a year apart.
Yeah.
And, I think he made some other movies, but, they're not as memorable, but you know, to have Casablanca come on the heels of that, a movie that was just another, it started out as a B programmer. It had been a play, hadn't gotten a lot of attention, called Everybody Comes to Rick's. It got a treatment. It then got into the A picture slate, but there was nothing special about it. And there was no sense that it would be any different from any of the other A pictures that they were doing at Warner Brothers that year. And literally, and they were writing the script day by day the Epstein brothers were on the set writing the script day by day. It was all shot in Burbank, basically. But as the shoot was happening, everybody began to get this feeling that they were doing something pretty special, which really is fascinating. But Ingrid Bergman was going up to the director, Michael Curtiz, and saying, well, what happens in the end here? Do I leave with Bogart? Do I leave with Paul Henri? What happens here? And the director, who was very Prussian, said, you know, just play it both ways, because he didn't know. Yeah. He literally didn't know how this movie was going to end.
Was Casablanca, that was in 42, was that based on a real incident, or was it just a book that, you know, a story that came out of somewhere, or was that based on anything that really happened in Morocco?
No, it was not based on anything real, but it gives you the feeling it was. No, it was this play called Everybody Comes to Rick's.
And was Bogart the first choice, or was
yes? At that time, they were. You know, Wallace had on the strength of the Maltese Falcon, Wallace was saying, "We're going to boost him up," and so that was he was definitely the first choice. Ingrid Bergman, though, was a fantastic choice. She's so beautiful in that movie, but. One of the problems they faced was that she was taller than Bogart.
Yeah.
And Paul Henri was also quite tall. So Bogart had to wear lifts in his shoes for certain shots where he was literally, you know, 3 to 5 inches taller to be able to be in the same frame as Ingrid Bergman.
Now, was that her first film? Because she had worked in Scandinavia before that, but this was her first American film.
No,
wasn't
it? She'd come over and she'd done Intermezzo.
Okay.
For Selznick, and she was definitely a rising star by that point. But again, this put her over the top. I think she resented in later years the fact that, you know, she felt she'd done a lot of good movies, but for her in particular, people just always thought of Ilse Lund. I mean, everybody talked about Casablanca. And she got a little tired of that. That's a nice problem to have.
Yeah, I know. It's because then when she, a decade later, when she was married to Roberto Rossellini, you know, she was doing all of these sort of arty films. I know I've read about that, how she thought, and I would agree. I think Casablanca is a terrific melodrama, but compared to, say, the films of an Ingmar Bergman or a Fellini, I don't think it's high art. I think it's a good melodrama. I enjoy melodrama for what it is, but I would not put, for example, I wouldn't put it on a par with, say, Citizen Kane, which is pure art. But I think it is a terrific melodrama. I know I read that in looking up that the famous scene at the end with the aeroplane was actually shot with midgets and because they couldn't fit on the studio lot, they couldn't fit a real plane, so they brought in like a plane that was a third the size, and they put midgets in the background to get the perspective. Are there any other stories like that about that film, or anything else like that?
Well, I mean, you know, it just gives you a sense of that's such a perfect example of why, you know, I've always been in love with the studio system and the golden era of Hollywood, because they did things like that. They were inventive. They couldn't rely on big budgets. They couldn't rely on computer-generated effects to do the job for them. They had to get creative. It's an absolutely wonderful story and completely true. So it was a model plane as well. Mm-hmm. I can't think of any other stories in terms of how the film was shot that was is that good. However, you know, just the fact that movie gives you such a sense of being in a foreign land, and that it was all shot in Hollywood. There was one exterior scene, I think, where the airplane arrives and Major Strasser comes off the plane, that was shot at Burbank Airport. But other than that, you know, it's all shot on a studio lot. And if you look at the film today, and I have to say that I do think Casablanca is a work of art. Yeah. Because the more you watch that film, the more you realize that it's the one film that I can say there's just nothing wrong with it. There's not a false note in that whole movie. There's not a wasted shot. And every time you see it, you see something new in it. So I don't know. They did not. I agree with you in saying when you say that it's not high art in terms of what they set out to do. But I think inadvertently they actually did create high art with that movie.
Well, it's also an example where that goes against the idea of the auteur theory, because basically this was a mélanger of, Curtiz, I don't really think you can consider him an auteur on par with some of the great Europeans or Orson Welles or whatnot. And as you said, they worked over the script relentlessly, so it wasn't like this was, you know, something that came out of the chute. So it's, I think, one of those rare instances where, you know, you did get a quality product from, you know, maybe some studio suits intervening or whatnot, but in that sense, it's a rarity. But what was the next big, was it Key Largo? Was that the next big bogey vehicle?
In those days, you made a lot of pictures every year. I mean, you make five or six movies, but the next movie really to talk about is To Have and Have Not, which was 2 years later. And that has a lot of lore behind it because, of course, that was the movie that introduced Bogey to Lauren Bacall, who was at that point a model, never acted in front of a camera, and was just 19 years old. Bogey was pushing 45. And it's just an amazing story because Howard Hawks was the director. The story there goes that Hawks was quite a drinker and was sitting with Ernest Hemingway, also quite a drinker, and bet him that he could make a great movie out of Hemingway's worst book. and basically Hemingway took the bet. Well, of course, Hawks won because To Have and Have Not is a minor Hemingway work, but Hawks is free to change it a lot, and he did. And it became a Bogart vehicle.
Yeah.
But it was Howard Hawks and Howard Hawks' wife, whose name was Slim, who found Lauren Bacall, literally saw a magazine cover, called her out for a test. She was shaking like a leaf. And Hawks started to sort of fall in love with this young woman and wanted to shape her. And indeed, the story goes that Slim Hawks, Howard Hawks' wife, was a major inspiration for the character that Lauren Bacall plays, this sort of slinky, sexy, tall, cool young woman, extremely self-assured, almost with an insolent look. This poor young 19 years old was absolutely petrified. The director with her and the star was in love with her, and that happened very, very quickly. And one thing I hadn't mentioned was that on the set of Casablanca, Ingrid Bergman had always said, you know, I kissed him, but I never knew him. Bogart and she did not have chemistry. And one of the reasons for that was Bogart at the time was married to an alcoholic actress named Mayo Method. And Mayo was had some career in film in the 30s. But then she was really going downhill and was an incredible alcoholic, frankly, as was Bogey, but Bogey could handle it. Well, she was also extremely jealous and nasty, and she'd stalk on the set of any Bogart picture, particularly after he became a star, and often start screaming and making scenes, and she had to be escorted off. She did that with Bergman a couple of times, but she really did it on To Have and Have Not with Bacall, because this time there was actually something happening.
I know I've read stories preparing for this that she actually put Bogart in the hospital one time, I think. She attacked him so violently.
She stabbed him in the back with a penknife or something. And Bogey was hilarious. He loved to drink, and he loved yelling and conflict. But he would, like, for instance, if there was a barroom brawl, he'd love to start it. But then he would love to get under the table and avoid anything happening. You know, because he was, to your point, he wasn't like Cagney. Cagney, you sense, would be right in there punching it out. Bogart, you know, was kind of a, he was, if you look at pictures of him, he was a very slight guy. This was a very, not a big dude at all. He was 5'8", and he was thin, rail thin, and a chain smoker, and, you know, didn't eat much, just drank. And, but he loved, you know, yelling and screaming. And if he could cause that to happen and then hide under the table, he'd be thrilled. So he loved Mayo Method. They had this, they were called the Battling Bogarts.
Yeah.
Because they'd be out and he would say something to get her going, and glasses would be flying and tables would be overturned. And so that was part of his, you know, he enjoyed that, weirdly enough.
Yeah.
But it was all, the minute he saw Bacall, it was pretty much all over. For that marriage.
So let's move on. Was Key Largo then the next big one? That was the next year after Have and Have Not?
No. Then Bogart would become the definitive Raymond Chandler in The Big Sleep, released in 1946. Actually, Dick Powell, the song and dance man from the 30s, was really the first Philip Marlowe on screen in terms of a feature film that is Philip Marlowe in a Raymond Chandler story. And he did a very good job. That's a movie called Murder My Sweet from 1944, co-starring Claire Trevor, who was a great friend of Bogart's. 2 years later, you have The Big Sleep. And again, that's Howard Hawks directing, and that's Bacall and Bogart. And that is an absolutely brilliant film. Although one of the hilarious stories about that movie was that it's so intricate in terms of all these bodies that are being found during this movie. They just pile up. That at one point, Bogart said to Hawks, well, who murdered the chauffeur?
Yeah.
And Hawks is going, well, damned if I know. And Hawks calls up Raymond Chandler, and Chandler says, I haven't a clue. That was pretty funny. I said, well, who cares? Nobody cares.
Yeah.
Such a good movie. It's so well-paced. And Bogart is just so great as Philip Marlowe, that it just works. And again, that Bogart Bacall chemistry is in full swing.
Yeah, I know that I've read of that too, because it's one of the few times in a Howard Hawks movie where he didn't have total control of the script. Because one of the reasons I've always favored Howard Hawks as a director over John Ford is because I always thought his scripts and his characters were better. Ford was always with that sort of mise-en-scene and the photography, but yeah. Hawks was more focused on the people and the characters. And you can look at a Howard Hawks film and you can find that you can relate to it in life. Whereas I think Ford was more romanticized. I just wanted to add, was he the thin man in the thin man films?
No, you're thinking of William Powell.
Okay.
William Powell, Dick Powell was the fellow in the Busby Berkeley musicals of 42nd Street.
Okay.
And Gold Diggers in 1933 and 35. He was, and I'll just, you know, I love this story so much. He was a very smart customer, and he knew that musicals were on the way out in the early 40s with the war on and everything else. And he went to RKO, wanted to sign him. He said, okay, I'll sign, but on one condition, you got to let me play a serious role, one serious role. Mm. And they let him do Murder, My Sweet, and his whole career was remade. And he'd spend the rest of that decade doing variations on The Tough Guy and some very good movies.
Okay. So what was the next Bogart film that, you know, in the canon?
Well, then, you know, I really would move on to a pair of films from 1948. One is Key Largo and one is Treasure of the Sierra Madre, in terms of his major films. Treasure of the Sierra Madre, every time I see it, I just think it's better and better and better and better. I think it's a brilliant film. And probably one of the best Bogart role to date, because it's a very complex role. Bogart is absolutely hateful as Fred Dobbs. He's a loser. He is, you know, totally down on his luck, basically homeless. in south of the border, and he's just trying to scrape up money to go out and try to find gold in them there hills. And then once they start to succeed, he and his two cohorts, one of whom is Walter Houston, the son, the father of the director. It was one of the first times a director in Hollywood had ever directed his father in a movie. And so then there's Tim Holt. And then the minute they start to find gold, Bogart turns into this greedy, suspicious, paranoid character. An absolutely hateful individual, and Bogart just went after it and did it. And it's really one of my favorite roles of his, because it's actually quite an unusual role in the Bogart canon. And then, of course, we have to remember Key Largo, which is also Houston, and a wonderful part for Edward G. Robinson in that. For those who haven't seen it, they should. You've got a coastal Florida hotel that is where there's a big typhoon coming in, and you've got Bogart, who's come to give a war medal. A buddy of his had been killed in the war. He's bringing a war medal to the widow, played by Lauren Bacall. Her crippled father's played by Lionel Barrymore, and then you have this gang of hoodlums sneaking back into the country. Who are on the lam, and that's Edward G. Robinson, and his drunken Moll is played by Claire Trevor. It's an absolutely fabulous film. And here you have Bogart as the good guy and Edward G. Robinson, who always got first billing in the 30s, as the bad guy.
Yeah.
And they basically shared top billing, but Bogart is to the left, so he technically has first billing. They were so clever in those days. And Robinson's name is beside him, but slightly above. Mm. So they're really sharing first billing on that film. But those two movies, to me, are sort of the apex of Bogart's career. 1948 really was his year.
Yeah, and the interesting thing about Sierra Madre is I can't think, if I think of stars of the last 20, 30 years, I can't imagine someone like a Tom Cruise playing such a despicable character as Fred Dobbs. Not only despicable in terms of being a bad guy, but a cowardly, craven bad guy. And yeah. I think that foreshadows the later part of Bogart's career. I had mentioned earlier how I had grown up being a Cagney fan. But as I got older and watched films and watched some of these films again, I have to say that Bogart made, that here's a guy who slogged the big time. He has a run of 5-6 years where he's, you know, if not the top box office star in Hollywood, certainly one of the two or three. And then he takes a role like this in Sierra Madre that goes totally against the type. I mean, he's not even playing a bad guy like Duke Manti in that he's a macho, testosteronic guy. He's this cowardly, craven little shit that you really want to see get popped at the end. And and he succeeds in that. And that foreshadows some of the later things. What do you think? To me, this says that Bogart really wasn't one of these star-driven guys. He actually, to me, was an actor. Do you think that?
That is absolutely true. You're dead on. The thing about Bogey was he knew himself, and he was himself a dark character. The story goes that he would run on his birthday, which was Christmas Day. He'd run A Star Is Born, the original Star Is Born, from 1937, and he would weep as he watched the film, and that's all about an alcoholic. And someone finally asked him, why do you keep watching? He basically said, I'm disappointed in myself. I expected more of myself, and now I'm never going to get it. Well, first of all, that's pretty wild to hear that from him, the biggest star in Hollywood. But also, he had a deep, dark recesses where he was, you know, he considered himself an actor who worked hard, but he knew his limitations. You know, he wasn't going to do Shakespeare. Yeah. And there was a side of him that didn't mind going to those dark places. For instance, he always said, you know, I used to be decent looking, but now I'm not. I got a lot of lines, and I've done a lot of drinking and a lot of smoking. They've given me these lines, and when I do a movie, I say, don't do anything about those lines. Don't try to hide my lines.
Yeah.
So he knew he had a face that had character, and he knew he had a face that betrayed pain and weakness, potentially weakness and vulnerability, and he wanted to use that. He wanted to use that. To him, that's what an actor should do. And,
well, let me just ask you, John, because I know he was bald in real life. Did he ever do a role where he wasn't wearing a toupee or anything?
No, he never did that. I mean, but he would go out in public sometimes without a toupee. That was really weird. I'm not exactly sure how that happened, because literally he had a full head of hair up until, I think, the mid-40s. And then it's like they were shampooing his hair in the studio and clumps started to come out. It could have been. He did not lead a very healthy lifestyle, as I've mentioned. But his baldness happened pretty suddenly. But no, he always had a toupee, to my knowledge.
Well, let's end this segment with talking about the last film that I guess would say that in his prime years, which is African Queen. And between Sierra Madre and African Queen, were there any other roles that were significant? Or if not, let's just talk a little bit about African Queen.
In a Lonely Place is one of my favorite sort of unsung Bogart films. That was Nicholas Ray from 1950. I love that movie. Bogey plays a screenwriter who is accused of murdering a young woman. And Gloria Graham, the great Gloria Graham, plays his neighbor who goes to bat for him and says that, you know, witness the fact that she'd left his place and all that, and saves his bacon, and they start a romance. But over time, Gloria Graham is wondering whether or not he might really have been guilty, because he's sort of this tortured guy who has fits of temper and a little bit unstable. Again, very dark character. And Louise Brooks, the great silent star who knew Bogart very well, said she thought that was the role that was closest to Bogart himself.
Yeah.
It is a movie that everybody should see, In a Lonely Place. But after that, there's The African Queen.
Yeah.
And that is a movie that, frankly, I just screened it recently for a group, and it was just so wonderful. It looks fantastic. It was Bogart's first color film.
Yeah, I was going to say that, yeah.
Yeah, it was Bogart's first color film. And, of course, John Huston wanted to do it. And John Huston wanted to work with Katharine Hepburn. Bogey and Hepburn had never worked together. That was going to be interesting. And of course, Huston wanted realism. So, you know, he found this incredibly remote spot in the Belgian Congo where he wanted to shoot this thing that would make the production a lot more complicated, because it was literally 2 days' hike from any civilization. The most from this that Hepburn, who was a fitness nut and incredibly sick, because she actually tried to drink water. And Bogart and Huston, on the other hand, were healthy and happy throughout the shoot, because all that Bogey drank was scotch, and all he would eat was black beans out of a tin, baked beans out of a tin. And he said, you know, if a fly came along and bit either Huston or me, it dropped dead.
Well, let's wrap this segment up, and let's watch a clip from one of his classic films, or a trailer from The Treasure of Sierra Madre. And when we get back, we'll talk about his decline in health and death in the last few films in his career, and then his legacy. So let's take a little break and watch that.
Up into the forbidding majesty of the great Madre range go men, their pasts buried in silent secrecy, their futures hidden in the mystery of adventure. Men drawn together in their search for gold. Don, soldier of fortune. Howard, the old-timer. Curtin, the youngster. And Cody, the intruder. These are the men who tried to tap the treasure of the Sierra Madre. Men with an oath on their lips and muscles in their arms, but men with greed in their hearts. Ready to break their backs, to sell their very souls for gold, fighting shoulder to shoulder against the forces of nature, only to find their greatest enemy is human nature.
Set your trap! Shut up, or I'll smash your head flat!
Go ahead, throw it! Without me, you two would die here more miserable than rats.
Leave him alone. Can't you see the old man's nuts?
Nuts! You're so dumb you don't even see the ridges you're treading on with your own feet.
The better, as far as I'm concerned. I don't want to keep that dame waiting, whoever she is.
We wounded this mountain. It's our duty to close her wounds. The least we can do to show our gratitude for the wealth she's given us.
You talk about that mountain like it was a real woman. She's been a lot better to me than any woman I ever knew.
I know exactly what you mean. You want to take it all for yourself and cut me out.
I know you for what you are. A long time I've had my suspicions about you. Now I know I've been right.
So that's your stinking game, is it? Informing. I knew you was an informer. I knew it all the time.
Take a look down that mountain. This means all our funerals.
What's that?
If I'm right in what I'm thinking, may the Lord be with us. They're not soldiers, they're bandits.
Back with John Farr, the film critic, and we're talking now about Humphrey Bogart's career, his life, and we're going to talk about his legacy. But John, you wanted to make a point about the African Queen being the only Oscar-winning role that Bogey had?
Yeah, he'd been nominated for Casablanca, and he hadn't won, which I still don't understand. Paul Lucas won for Watch on the Rhine, which is a good film, but not anything like Casablanca. But The African Queen was his Oscar. He was nominated a second time, and this time he won. And he'd always said to his friend Claire Trevor, who I actually knew in her later years, he said, you know, if you're going to go up there and accept an Oscar, and she won one for Key Largo, you know, just don't thank anybody. You know, all these people go up and thank people. Don't thank anybody. Say you did it all yourself. That was Bogart through and through, this contrarian spirit that he had. When he won the Oscar, he was very good. He went up and he credited Kate Hepburn and John Huston, and he said when he got his honorary Oscar, you know, do it by yourself, helped by others. And it was an incredibly gracious acceptance speech.
So let's talk about the latter, the post-African Queen career of Bogey. And as I mentioned earlier, he sort of came, if not 180 degrees, certainly close to it, in that he took a lot of offbeat roles. I don't know if he was always the top. He must have been the top bill star all the time, but I don't think he necessarily always had the top screen time. I'm just looking at some of the list of films. Beat the Devil comes to mind. I remember that one. Sabrina, of course, I remember that one. The Barefoot Contessa. Where No Angels was a remake, I think, with Robert De Niro some years later. And then the Desperate Hours, which we'll see a trailer from later. What is your take on his post-African Queen, sort of his sunset years?
You know, at that point, he wanted to do what he wanted to do. And he had a lot more autonomy. He made some mistakes. I mean, some of those movies you mentioned really don't hold up very well.
Yeah.
Sabrina does. And I think that would be the movie I'd start with to talk about, because there was amazing backstory behind that film.
And it's a Billy Wilder movie.
Billy Wilder film. He and Bogart hated making it.
Oh, yeah.
First of all, he knew that Cary Grant had been the first choice. Cary Grant had turned it down, wasn't able to do it. Cary Grant would have been better in the part. There's no question about it,
yeah,
in my mind. So Bogart went into it because he wanted to work with Wilder. He knew Wilder. But the minute he got on the set, he was not enjoying it. Part of it was that Wilder and William Holden were very close, because basically Wilder had made William Holden's later career by casting him in Sunset Boulevard. And they did Stalag 17 and everything else. So they were very, very tight. And Bogey didn't much care for Holden's sort of whole act. And then Holden and Audrey Hepburn were having an affair. So that was going on. So there were a lot of Google eyes going at each other, which Bogart found nauseating. And then Audrey Hepburn, who was the nicest woman in the world, was still very green as an actress.
Yeah.
So what, somebody asked Bogart, how do you like working with Audrey Hepburn? And he said, oh, it's fine if you don't mind 30 takes. So, you know, he was a consummate professional, and he was impatient with this young woman who was just learning how to be a movie star and an actress.
Yeah,
so this all combined to make for a very tense set. Mm.
Yeah, you know, you mentioned Cary Grant. I would not have thought of Bogart in a Cary Grant role, and you'd mentioned earlier, too, some of his limitations. It's like, I couldn't imagine, for example, Bogart doing Eugene O'Neill. You know, he just would not have fit in, say, as Hickey in The Iceman Cometh. You know, I just couldn't see that. But of his post African Queen films, would you say then? Do you think Sabrina was the best of them?
No, not necessarily. For the very reason I mentioned, the one problem with that movie is he really isn't ideally cast. Again, we talk about the fact that he was proud of his lines, of the fact that he was aging. But by 1954, it was very difficult to believe that Bogey could be a leading man. In other words, a romantic lead, which he is in that movie. It didn't really work because he's beginning to look really tired, and he's almost beginning to look ill, which, frankly, you know, the fact that this was a guy who was very much like his friend Spencer Tracy. You just couldn't believe that he was only 54 and he looked 64. And that was years of drinking and years of smoking, two packs of Chesterfields a day. So you didn't really buy him as a romantic lead, but the movie itself is delightful. But you know, I also like The Desperate Hours, which happened the following year. That was a movie that paired him with Frederick March, who was really one of the great movie actors of his day. And actually, that was almost going to be Spencer Tracy and Bogey. And that would have been amazing, Spencer Tracy in the Frederick March role. But Tracy wanted – they fell out because Tracy wanted first billing and Bogart wanted first billing. They couldn't agree, so Tracy backed off, even though they remained very close friends. So – that movie was excellent, and that's William Wyler directing. And it is a return for Bogart to the Duke Mantee type of role, the gangster role. And again, there are a lot of parallels to the Petrified Force because he literally, you know, takes people hostage.
Yeah.
A desperate man, on the lam, convict. And so I think that movie is particularly fascinating, and it's extremely well done.
Yeah, it's almost like it's Duke Mantee Part 2 almost, 20 years later.
Yeah. And then I should also mention a movie he did just before that one, which is The Caine Mutiny. Now that I think about it, I think probably it would be the king, not just because he got his third Oscar nomination for it, but just because, again, that was a role that was perfect for Bogey, where he got to go to very deep, dark, kind of scary places, as we literally witness a great officer, a man of honor, literally descend into madness. And that's what we've seen. Anybody who hasn't seen that movie should, because the final scene in the courtroom where we realize that Bogart's character really is breaking down and going insane and is having a breakdown, is one of the great moments in Bogart's career in terms of performance. Amazing film.
Now, Bogart died, what was it, of lung cancer?
He died of lung cancer. It was first diagnosed in 1956. He made one last movie, which is also excellent, that a lot of people don't know, called The Harder They Fall, about the boxing, the corruption within the industry, loosely based on the story of a boxer named Primo Carnera. There in that film, you really see this is one very ill man. Again, he's only 56, and he looks like an old man. And he'd been diagnosed with esophageal cancer.
Okay.
And it was way beyond, you know, there was nothing they could really do. In those days, they couldn't do very much anyway.
Yeah.
I guess there was one very invasive surgery where they took out part of his throat and a rib and all that stuff. But basically, he was a goner. And he withdrew from the next project he wanted to do. He went home. He had his treatments, but he was losing weight. If you could see the list of stars and Hollywood notables who visited him in his final months, you'd be just amazed. I mean, it's like a who's who of Hollywood royalty who came to his home in Holmby Hills and paid tribute to him. He would be put in a wheelchair towards the end. He weighed less than 100 pounds, and he'd be put in a dumbwaiter and brought down, and he'd be wheeled out, and he'd have one scotch with his friends, be it Sinatra, be it David Niven, be it Judy Garland and Sid Luft, be it Spencer Tracy and Katharine Hepburn, and he would reminisce. And then January 14th, 1957, he died. A very lovely story. The night before he died, he saw Spencer Tracy, who he just adored and adored him. And Tracy's getting up to leave. And Bogey's about 80 pounds at that point. And he puts his hand on the skeletal shoulder and he says, "Good night, Bogey." And by the way, Tracy was supposedly the one who gave him the nickname Bogey. Mm-hmm. He says, "Good night, Bogey." And Bogart looks up at him and puts his hand on Tracy's hand, over Tracy's hand, and says, "Goodbye, Spence." And it was electrifying. He was so upset. And indeed, he died the next day. And then Tracy was asked to do the eulogy and just said, "I can't. I can't do it. It's too emotional for me." And so John Huston did the eulogy.
Now, you mentioned some of the people from the Rat Pack. A lot of people don't, they associate with the 60s and Frank Sinatra, but actually the term originated with Bogart, and I believe he was sort of the originator of the Hollywood Rat Pack, was he not?
Yes, it was actually Betty Bacall who named it. She came in, it was just a group of Bogart and Bacall's cronies who would sit around and get plastered at night. They just loved, you know, their whole purpose was to drink lots of whiskey.
Yeah.
That was their stated goal. And so one night Bacall came in and looked at this group and said, "You guys all look like a goddamn rat pack." And the name stuck. And Sinatra was part of it from early days. And I think Bogart was the director of publicity. but later on, it got attached somehow to Sinatra.
Yeah.
And so that then became, you know, Dean Martin and Sammy Davis and Peter Lawford. And Sinatra hated that because he knew that was not the real Rat Pack. The real Rat Pack was Bogey and Bacall and himself and a few other, you know, probably David Niven and a few other notables. And he didn't want that name, that hallowed name, transferred to his own group.
Yeah. Well, let's before we talk a little bit about his legacy of the last half century or so, let me just ask you: do you know if there was any directors that or film projects that Bogart had wanted but never got to do? I mean, obviously the big one to me would be Hitchcock. Did he ever have any offers to work with Hitchcock or, you know, do any of the classic roles?
Not to my knowledge. You know, I don't, in all the reading I've done on Bogey, I don't know if he was this and he could and he didn't do it, or you know, he wanted to do it but he wasn't able to do it.
No,
there may be one or two we don't know about, but I mean, frankly, the last project that he was involved with was not something that sounded particularly notable.
Yeah.
Or I'm not even sure it got made. No, I really, that wasn't,
yeah.
You know, I think that the nice thing about Bogart was that he did his best work over a 15-year period. He did some clunkers, as all actors do, but he increasingly got more independent and he was able to do what he wanted to do. And it's pretty amazing how many great movies he made over a 10 to 15 year period.
Do you think that if he had lived another 15 or 20 years as the studio system was crumbling, do you think he would have exerted more power? Was his star already on the wane by the time he was dying?
It's hard to say, because to think of Bogart living 15 or 20 more years is just a little strange, because part of his persona was the fact that this was a hard living dude and that he looked it. So that part of it, you know, part of the fact you look at Bogart and you can see this guy's living hard and living fast. So the notion that he would have been this fellow, you know, like Jimmy Stewart, who lived to be 80 and go on the Tonight Show, 88 actually, you know, it's sort of like a very strange thing to see. I don't think that his career would have gone downhill, though. I really don't, because he was unique. He was an extremely good actor, and indeed, as we'll talk later, the persona that he had, which was basically a cynic with a heart of gold underneath, is something that was very appealing and timeless, and that is why, as I know we'll discuss, his legacy persisted and indeed grew.
Yeah.
After his death.
Well, let's talk about that. You know, John Wayne has, you know, Hey Pilgrim, and Jimmy Cagney has You Dirty Rat, and, you know, there was the famous, the Woody Allen did it in the early 70s, the Bogey parody in one of his comedies or whatnot. What do you think contributed to the rise? Because I read that it was in the late 60s that some film critics had sort of, Bogart had sort of been eclipsed by the sort of rise of the new Hollywood and the directors that came in the 60s when the studio system was breaking down, but around the late 60s, early 70s, his star started to rise again after about a decade or so of not necessarily obscurity, but sort of just going into a slight decline. What do you think about his persona in his roles led to this, whereas someone like, say, you mentioned William Holden, you know, who was certainly an actor who did a lot of roles and whatnot, Holden hasn't had the impact. Do you think he it's just one of those fluke things, or when you weigh these kinds of actors, why is a John Wayne an icon, a Bogart an icon, whereas William Holden was a star, but you know, he's not in that league?
Well, William Holden, you know, it's a very, very good question. William Holden was a very good actor, very handsome, who could do a part well and look great on screen. He didn't have a persona. When you say what was the William Holden persona, you can't really go that deep. Yeah. Whereas with Bogart and Duke Wayne, I mean, John Wayne was brilliant because he knew what he wanted to be. He had an image in mind. It was almost like I was in advertising for many years. It's almost like a brand. Yeah. To say, okay, I'm going to be completely unique. I'm going to have my own stamp that people are either going to totally love and know and expect, or they're not, but it's going to be mine. And that was, you know, the drawl and the way he walked, and that became uniquely John Wayne, and people loved it.
Yeah, I mean, John Wayne, you could just see a silhouette of him from behind, his posture, even yeah. without cowboys, just the way yeah. he stood. It's as iconic as Chaplin's tramp.
Exactly. And then, it, of course, using that, he became the symbol of America, because in the 40s, 50s, and 60s, when the people in Europe thought of America, they thought of cowboys.
Yeah.
So, and Westerns. And so that was what we were all known for. And so. but his presence on screen helped us. It became part of the culture, the zeitgeist. And the same is true for Bogart. And really, with Bogey, it was almost just a couple of years after his death that he had this renaissance, and it started two places almost simultaneously. The first was the Brattle Theater in Cambridge, you know, where undergraduate Harvard students went. There was some kind of I think it was Casablanca that was just be played a lot. And lo and behold, all of a sudden, all these students were coming into the theater, all these, you know, college students who either never seen the movie or had forgotten it. And it ran for an absurd amount of time, and young people would just go and see it and see it and see it. And there became this sort of Bogart craze because he was so effortlessly cool. Yeah. You know, the cigarette, the way he spoke, the fact he didn't care, the fact that he would look convention in the face and say, screw it, when I, you know, I don't buy it. The fact he hated phonies, that was his word, he hated phonies. The fact that he was the cynic who was extremely honorable underneath. People loved this persona, this character, and they also saw that he was a hell of a good actor. And so all of a sudden there's sort of Bogart explosion going among the young people. And then at the same time, there's Jean-Luc Godard over in Paris, and the French New Wave is coming in, and this movie called Breathless comes out with Jean-Paul Belmondo. And who does he play? He plays a Bogart fanatic. And his whole character is built around this fascination with the mystique of Humphrey Bogart. And so those two things together ensured that Bogart would really never be forgotten.
Well, let's wrap up this segment then. And let me just ask, where do you think, say, you know, if a film historian, say, 100, 150 years from now is looking back, or even a sociologist looking back at classic Hollywood, do you think that in 100, 150 years that Bogart will still be, like, at the top of the list, like in the AFI? Or do you think, you know, there will be someone like a William Holden or you know, someone else who people are going to come back and look at? Do you think that his roles have, you know, the stamina that when people look back 20th century film, which, you know, let's face it, for better or worse, Hollywood will be looked back as you know, American film as the definitive 20th century film. Do you think that he's going to have legs to that, you know, people in 300-400 years are going to be saying, oh, I want to watch that Bogart, you know, if they're, whether they're going around a moon of Saturn or in, on another, you know, that they're going to pop in a Bogart film or something and still get something from it?
No, I want to say yes.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm going to say yes. And I'm also going to say I certainly hope so. Uh-huh. Because the truth is, again, as I said before, all you got to do is look at the movies, and which is what really I'm in the business of encouraging people to do. And of course there's Casablanca, of course there's Key Largo, but you know, a movie like The Desperate Hours, a movie like The Caine Mutiny, a movie like The African Queen, you just look at these movies and you see an extremely gifted actor who is also completely unique. This is not a pretty boy. This is not some strapping, beautiful leading man. This is frankly a rather scrawny guy who drinks too much and smokes too much and has got some sort of element of pain within him, and yet has enormous integrity. And I think that all of that in combination will ensure that people will never forget Bogart, that he will always draw people because he is so unique.
Okay, so why don't we end this segment? We'll watch a trailer from his penultimate film, Desperate Hours. When we get back, John, we'll talk a little bit about your site. best movies by far and what you're trying.
The early morning escape was cleverly masterminded by Glenn Griffin. He, his younger brother Hal, and another convict named Kobish brutally overpowered a guard and fled without arousing suspicion.
Take it easy, lady. Easy, I said, easy. You scream and the kid will come home and find you in a pool of blood.
Dan.
What are you doing here, Griffin? They're looking all over five states for you.
They ain't looking here, Pop.
You can get brave just about any time you feel like it, any one of you. You might even get away with it. That ain't saying what's going to happen to the others.
How long?
About midnight, maybe sooner.
What if the police come? What if they find you here?
It wouldn't be pretty. If that happens, you folks get it first. Now get out in the kitchen and cook that chicken I seen in the icebox.
Do it yourself. My wife's not your servant.
Filthy!
Ellie!
Ellie! Why don't you pick on someone of your own size?
The whole family's getting tough. Listen, idiot. You ain't calling a tune. I got my guts full of you, shiny-shoed, down-your-nose wise guys with white handkerchiefs in their pockets. Next time, I'll wipe them on you. Now get out there and cook!
Back with John Farr, and John has a website called The Best Movies by Farr, and I will link to it underneath this video. It is www.bestmoviesbyfarr.com. Same name as the actor who played the cross-dressing clinger on MASH, but
I wish you hadn't brought that up.
So, John, let's talk a little bit about your website. I know before we had done the interview, you had talked about wanting to sort of collate and bring together classic movies from the past and quality. Hulu, the Netflixes are basically just sort of, you know, throwing things down. What basic premise behind your website?
So again, the idea that there's really effective curation on the Amazons and the Netflixes and Hulus of the world is just it isn't so. They have a lot of product that they want to push out to their audience. And so that's not all bad. That's the way of the world. But what it forces the consumer to do is to sift through a lot of mediocre or actually very bad choices to get to finally a good choice or a very good choice. It takes a lot of work. The blunt truth about the movie business is that only about 1 out of 10 movies are worth seeing. And I don't mean that as a criticism of the people who make movies. The truth is it's very hard to make a very good movie. It doesn't just take skill, it takes a measure of luck. And there are not a lot of them out there. And there's a lot of movies that aren't very good. And that you're going to sit and spend 2 hours of your time watching something where you go at the end, or you nod off, is just to me sad when there are so many movies out there, old and new, that are fantastic, but that don't get the publicity and exposure they should.
And how long have you had your website up?
The site's been around for about a decade, but a lot of that time was just spent on actually populating it. So in other words, I have spent since 2004, so we were talking 11 years, literally researching, and then screening these movies and then writing them up and putting them on the site. So what you've now got is just under 2,700, not reviews, but recommendations. So every movie on there is a firm recommendation. And all you really need to do is say, does this meet my taste? Is this in line with my taste in movies? And is this in line with my mood right now? I'm saying to people, probably enjoy what I'm recommending.
This model that you have, I think we had mentioned earlier that the movies you recommend, you would get some kind of, I guess people who watch it through your portal, would you get some kind of remuneration through that. Is this anything, so I know in recent years, last couple of years, I've seen these little channels that have come up like moviesnetwork.com and GetTV that have had the back, the old classics from like, I think, Columbia Pictures and maybe it might be Paramount or whatnot. Do you go out and then do you contact, say, some of the studios can I recommend, you know, Key Largo, say, or is this just your own private venture?
Don't need to do that. And frankly, I've very much wanted to focus on the movies themselves, and it's a big job, because we're talking about the classics today, but I'm also looking at new movies, both movies made here and movies made all over the world. And frankly, you know, the news is that the best movies being made today are not being made in this country. They're being made all over the world. And the reason for that is that most countries other than the United States actually have government support for movies that are aimed for an educated audience, an adult audience. So I got to track all of those. Plus, we have a very robust documentary section. The one sort of area that I think is very exciting in movies being made in the United States is documentaries. And there are a lot of them, and I got to track them. So I really focus on being kind of a detective, going around trying to find these movies that are fantastic, that are sort of hidden gems that not enough people have heard about.
Yeah, I agree about the documentaries. I've said that for the last 5-10 years, that I think it's the only part of the American movie scene that's in, if not a golden age, certainly a silver age. I know I just recently turned 50, and it was only about a decade ago that I grew up fairly poor, and when I'd watch movies, they'd be on TV, like we mentioned some of the television shows in New York. I'd sneak into theaters when I was a kid. Younger people don't remember that movies would play for 18 months sometimes when they come out, not just the, you know, six weeks and then out. But I remember discovering a lot of foreign films in the last decade, the Ingmar Bergman's, to me, if you were to ask me the greatest film that I've ever seen, I'd have to go with La Dolce Vita by Fellini. Yep. Let's talk a little bit about some world cinema, then expand a little bit beyond Hollywood. What would you, I know I found that the Japanese cinema of the 50s and 60s, Kurosawa, Ozu, Mizoguchi, Kobayashi, do you have a certain section that's foreign, or like Japanese, Italian cinema?
Yeah. If you go on the site you hit movies, tab, you realize that you see that there are filters, and you can search our database by country, and by a decade, and by genre, and by mood. And you could do more than one. But in Japanese movies, all the movies that you're talking about, expect to see on there in terms of the great classics of international cinema from the, from the 40s, 50s, and 60s, are on there. But there are a lot of other movies being made in these countries today that are fantastic. And I just want to mention that if people say to me, well, what's your plan? I mean, what do you tend to be drawn to? The whole notion of best movies by far is to focus on movies that are rich in story and script. So, people say when they see a Hollywood movie today, they say, well, Julianne Moore was very good in that movie. Well, of course, Our problem today in Hollywood is not that the acting is poor. The acting is great. The problem is the scripts and the stories that are getting made are formulaic and dumbed down. And so what you're getting in international cinema is you're getting intelligent stories, what I call human scale stories. So they're stories not about people wearing capes, but about how it is to be alive. Right. And so you have to do it, that they don't get the distribution or the awareness over here that they should.
What do you, I call it the puralization, that everything has this sort of Hollywood teenage rom-com kind of thing to it. But, you know, as I've gotten older, I mean, you'd mentioned earlier John Huston. I think his famous quote, I don't know if it's apocryphal or not, is that there was never been a great movie made that didn't have a great screenplay. And, there's all different ways to have a great screenplay. I think 2001 A Space Odyssey has a terrific screenplay, even though a lot of people don't seem to recognize that. Mm-hmm. La Dolce Vita has a great screenplay. But you look at a lot of the stuff of the last, starting in the 9th century, and everything is so formulaic. We have, franchise name 6, 7, yeah, 8. Whereas in the old days, you would have, we mentioned the Thin Man movies, it might be the Thin Man Goes to Harlem or the Thin Man Solves the Case. And there used to be these movie series, but it wasn't just 1, 2, 3, whereas the exact same thing over again. You would get, even the lesser movies, the Charlie Chan movies which had a number of actors, they would at least be doing something, and it would be a fairly intelligent script. Even, yes, Charlie Chan was kind of racist and whatnot, but at least Charlie Chan himself was intelligent. Yeah. And now it's just it's regurge and regurge and regurge. Yeah. What do you think accounts for that?
Well, I think that the Hollywood industry today is being run by people who don't really love movies as movies. Mm. I mean, the old studio moguls in the Golden Age studio system, they were businessmen. They wanted to make money, and they made a lot of silly movies that made money, but they also cared about movies as a whole and as an art form. They did. They cared about it because for them, they remembered when movies meant going and looking at a Nickelodeon of a train coming at you. So their whole orientation was to build up the prestige of film and of what movies could be and could do. They had that attitude. Now, that went away. Now we have people in Hollywood who are saying, here's our business model, okay? We're going to get, we're going to focus on the younger audience because they're the ones who are going into the movie theaters, and we're going to need to focus on doing movies that are, I don't know they would put it this way, but are vanilla enough and broadly targeted enough to go across borders. Yeah. So there are a lot of movies that were greenlit, even 20 years ago that would never be made today. I mean, one example is American Beauty. I'm not sure that movie would ever be made today because what you've got is exactly what you're saying. These franchises that are either animated stuff for kids or silly rom-coms for teens and tweens, action pictures, loud action pictures, comic book movies, anything that involves a lot of special effects, which is what we are known for around the world, and that plays. So they're saying that's all we're going to do because the business model has gone from being 30% international, 70% domestic, to the other way around. Mm. So it's just we're locked into this. The problem is what's actually up on the screen is not very good.
And it doesn't even last. I had mentioned some of these movie channels like Get TV and whatnot. And sometimes I'll see an interesting movie. Just yesterday I saw Behold the Pale Horse with Gregory Peck playing a Spanish fighter who was with Anthony Quinn. And it wasn't either their best roles. Yeah. So, but even in this, maybe second tier level film, it's still leagues above even the most serious kind of thing. I mean, you'll have a Terrence Malick, you'll have, the fellow Steve McQueen. His first three films, I think, have been terrific. I think he's right up there with the masters. There was another film I saw that they have coming out on one of these channels that they were showing. It's from the late 90s with the guy from Gladiator, the Australian fellow.
Russell Crowe.
Russell Crowe and Denzel Washington in some late 90s, early O's fiction computer. And the just so outdated, and it's so dependent upon graphics, because there's nothing there. It's just cartoon characters, you know. Yeah. And yeah, you can if you're gonna have, you can maybe have one good Batman movie one up, but when you get to Batman 4 or 5, you know, the Joker farts, you just lose it. And it's like I recently joined AARP because I turned 50, and excuse me, and you know, you hear all this stuff about, oh, the teens have the disposable incomes. Well, teens make crap, you know. Yeah. it's people your age and my age that, you know, that want to go out and have a good time and maybe see something a little bit intelligent. And it doesn't necessarily have to be a classic that's going to be watched in 50 years, but at least should attempt it. And I watched an Andrei Tarkovsky film the other day, and it wasn't one of his top ones. It was Nostalgia, his penultimate film. And but it's still, again, even if it's not the best thing that the guy did, it's reaching for something. It's saying, here's something that, like I said, 500 years from now, if someone is circling around some star and they've got 5 weeks to go to deliver their ore to whatever, they can put in there and say, I understand that. I don't think that someone in there is going to be able to turn on a romantic comedy or some silly, Die Hard 23 and say, you know, oh, that I really understand that. It's just so passe and so quickly. The expiration date is just gone.
No, there's no question about it. It's like Chinese food. You know, you're hungry 2 hours after. You're right. And one of the things that I love about older movies is that, for instance, the great director Ernst Lubitsch, he felt that he had an intelligent audience. And he thought that if he gave his audience credit for intelligence, for being able to pick up on subtle humor and in very intelligent, sophisticated dialogue, they'd rise to the occasion. That was his attitude.
Yeah.
The opposite is the case today. Hollywood gives us no credit for intelligence. They think that we will, you know, they think they can use computer-generated effects and dazzle us visually, and that we don't really need a great story, and that we don't really need a great script. Everything now is grunts. I was watching Interstellar, which is an interesting movie, but Christopher Nolan, the music's so damn loud, and then Matthew McConaughey is sort of talking like this. I don't understand what he's saying. So it to me, it's emblematic of this thing where dialogue really isn't that, script isn't really that important anymore, or Hollywood doesn't think it is. And, you know, making these movies inside a computer is not helping this medium. And the truth is that I'm not saying special effects are bad or anything else, but you can't use it as a crutch. Or if you do use it as a crutch, you're forgetting about the fundamentals that make great movies great. And it does start with story and script. And we're losing that here. Thank God we still have it other places in the world. But I just want to say, there are exceptions. I say 1 out of 10 movies. But 1 out of 10 means you got to deal with 9 that aren't so hot. And you got to know to get past them to the one good one. And so that's what Best Movies by Far is about, is getting you to that one good one without you getting frustrated and giving up.
Yeah. Well, let's before we go back and talk about, you know, who you are and your growing up and your love of movies, let me just ask you a question, since you had mentioned about computer graphics and whatnot. I read something some months ago, and I don't remember if it was online or in maybe one of these magazines when I was at a doctor's office, although most people at doctor's offices now just are addicted to their phones rather than actually reading the magazines. But I read something about, and I think it might have been the Bogart estate, that some old-time Hollywood actors like the Bogart estate or the Cagney estate or Charlie Chaplin, that they are thinking of somehow leasing the rights to the images for computerized movies in the next decade or so. What do you, I mean, I'd have to think, to me, this is insane. This is like colorizing movies. I mean, a digitized Humphrey Bogart, you know, in a movie, say, with John Wayne and Charlie Chaplin, you know, some banana. I mean, the whole idea just seems so damn bizarre. I mean, have you heard of these kinds of things about these rights?
I can only hope. I can't really visualize. I only hope that they will be very careful about the use of those images.
Yeah.
And I'm presuming that that will be the case. It won't just be, oh, you can do whatever you want with it. It'll have to get vetted and approved to say exactly how are you using, you know, Bogart's image or Chaplin's or anything else. But it is very strange to me. I mean, I remember that movie Dead Men Don't Wear Plaid? Carl Reiner. I mean, that was sort of the first time they took images from old movies and almost tried to make them sort of three-dimensional within another movie. And I mean, that was just a comedy, and it didn't really work. But I don't love it, obviously, because it's chopping up pieces of what is a very important whole that should have its own integrity. But then on the other hand, I like the fact that these icons are being remembered, and because that's important. I mean, you know, it's my kids know Bogart, my kids know Cagney. They know it because I've talked about it, but they also know it because there's enough sort of awareness of it that they got to a certain age where they sat down and started watching the movies, and then they went, oh my God, these guys are great.
Yeah. Well, I could imagine sort of if there was a good script set in the 30s or 40s, like the old Roger Rabbit thing, where you might have just a 90-second cameo, that it could work. But I can't imagine building a film around, say, you know, a Bogart and a Duke Wayne and a buddy comedy kind of thing. But
yeah.
Let us talk about we talked a little bit about who you were early on. Let's talk about your childhood. How did you get into film watching? If you were in New York, you must remember a fellow named Joe Franklin, the old Joe Franklin show. As a child, I remember in the early 70s, that's how I found out about silent films and Chaplin, Keaton, Lloyd, the Keystone Cops, Fatty Arbuckle and whatnot. What was your first exposure to film? Was it something like that, a television show, the old repeats of the Our Gang comedies or the Dead End Kids or the Bowery Boys or whatnot?
Well, I watched all that. I mean, I was never afraid of black and white because I grew up in an era where for a while we had black and white TVs.
Yeah.
And I was watching Officer Joe Bolton and the Three Stooges. I preferred the curly ones.
Yeah.
And I remember Joe Franken. But it really was coming home and turning on the 4:30 movie in New York City, which always had the great films from the 30s and 40s starring Bogey, starring Spencer Tracy, starring Cary Grant, starring Jimmy Cagney, starring Jimmy Stewart, starring Henry Fonda, and loving that group of actors.
And then
I became completely obsessed with it, and I started reading books about these actors and studying up on them. And in fact, when I was young, I did imitations. So I did Bogey, I did Cary Grant, I did all these. I don't do them anymore, but I used to do them. Mm-hmm. And I became fascinated with film and how films get made. So it's been a lifelong thing. But I fell into the advertising business after I went to Princeton. I fell into the advertising business, got into a great firm called Ogilvy in New York. Was there for 17 years and learned a lot. I don't have any regrets about it. It taught me how to write. It taught me about branding, strategy, execution, all that stuff. But I wanted out. When I got to be 40, I had that moment where I said, I've done it. I'm enough. And I saw this need. And that, again, was what advertising teaches you is, you know, you gotta see a need, a consumer need that's important. And the one that I saw was what I call the blockbuster syndrome. Mm. In those days, what is Amazon today was a physical place. It was Blockbuster Video, and you'd go in and your girlfriend called you up and said, hey, get a movie for tonight, honey. You know, we're just staying in. And you walked in and you went, oh my God, all you saw were the sea of boxes. How am I going to make a decision? Because the very important insight about movies is that it's a high involvement decision. What does that mean? That means if you pick a movie and you have a couple of friends over and your wife is there, your girlfriend, whatever, and the movie stinks, you feel like an idiot. You don't just say, oh, well, you know, who cares? It's a reflection on you and your judgment. So watching a movie, which we all have, you really try to pick something good. Plus, it's 2 hours. You have a lot of downtime these days, so it's important. And so I saw this need for helping people find the good stuff quickly, because you can't find the good stuff quickly right now. How many people have I spoken to who go on their Apple TV of a given evening, now that it's a streaming culture, and they sit in front of it with their clicker, and they go like, and they're looking at movies, click, 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 and then after 20 minutes, they give up and go to sleep. To me, that is criminal. So what I'm trying to do is to say to people, don't do that. Come to Best Movies by Far, find what you're looking for, figure out what you're in the mood for, you find something and watch it. Just watch it. And you're going to be happy. And guess what? You'll probably start watching movies more frequently because you're having a better experience watching movies. You're getting more out of them. And so that's the very simple philosophy. And as the technology has moved from VHS to DVDs that you actually get in a physical store to the Netflix model of DVDs that are sent to you, to now the new model of Netflix and Amazon and other entities who are offering streaming of movies, which is a hell of a big deal because you can see whatever you want, whenever you want, wherever you want,
yeah,
at that moment without waiting.
On whatever device, too.
You want. This is a revolution. But the problem is we're so clogged with junk that people who are smart are sitting there going, look, I've had a long day. I just want someone to tell me what's really good. And if you tell them, they'll watch it. But it's too hard to find. Unless, you know, oh, well, I was going to see that in the theaters. It got all these great reviews, all this buzz. And now it's just come out on pay-per-view. I'm going to watch it. That's fine. That doesn't happen that frequently.
Yeah.
So what do you do in the meantime? So that's what that's all about.
Well, let me ask you a business question regarding your website. One of the things that I think with the move from the physical disc to the streaming that I think has been lost, probably the O's, the aughts, the noughts, whatever you want to call the last decade, was probably the golden age of DVD commentaries. And one of the things that I found very interesting was not every commentary was good. A lot of it was a lot of just glad handing, especially if you had a director and the star and they laughed half through half of it. But there were a lot of good commentaries. Some of them were historically based, especially like I have some Cagney and Hitchcock box sets where you get a lot of information about the director did this, the backstage story, some of the things you talked about. In other commentaries, you get really a dissection of scenes and whatnot. And I'm wondering, in the future, do you have any plans maybe in the future? I know there used to be MST3K kind of riff tracks kind of thing where that you might offer at some point commentaries or something as the medium evolves. I mean, what is your future things that you plan maybe in the next couple of years? Is something like that in the offing?
Well, it's interesting you asked that question because what I actually do now, and I hadn't mentioned it because Best Movies by Far is more than a website, is I go all up and down mainly the East Coast doing talks and introducing movies. I'm not a big fan personally of commentary tracks throughout a whole movie because I think it takes your concentration away from what the director intended, which is that you follow the story and follow the dialogue and everything else. And that was never my favorite thing. Mm-hmm. And I think some buffs, movie buffs, love it because they've seen the movie already and they want to hear what the director has to say frame by frame. That's fine. I don't think that's something that's a huge deal for most movie watchers who are more casual. Mm-hmm. But to your point, what I love to do is to go and pick a great film and get an audience and take 10 minutes and tell them the 5 to 10 different elements, stories, pieces of trivia, background, context that make them literally lean forward in their chair so that by the end of my talk, they say, put on the movie, put on the movie. To do that, and I perfected it because I've been doing this for, again, talks, all private events all over the country, and clubs and organizations, and it always works. People want that extra nugget of insight into a movie, into how it was made, into what was going on when it was made, into how the director worked with the stars, how the stars got along, why it's important as a film, placing it in context. People love that. I call it going behind the velvet rope, which is sort of understanding what was going on the set, all that stuff. And so that will never go out of style, and I will continue to do more and more of those speaking engagements. And, you know, my hope is to be able to get on air and to do more of it that way as well.
Do you have, like, are you planning maybe like having a film festival? Because I know when in researching this, the Bogart Estate has a Bogey Film Festival, I think, down in the Keys. Do you plan on sometime maybe having like a 10 movie marathon, say at a theater in New York?
Yes. I mean, movie club where people come and I curate movies and in bringing back historic cinemas and turning them into arts houses, a not-for-profit, member-supported arts houses that show classic films, but also independent documentary and foreign films, first run, and doing events and having celebrities come. And I've interviewed, you know, Paul Newman and Tim Robbins and Robert Altman and all these people on stage. I want to do more of that because I'm now got another cinema that I'm doing that. Where I'm doing that, very exciting, up in Bedford, New York, which is north of New York City by about an hour, and there are tons of celebrities.
Is that near Kingston? Is that up near Kingston?
I don't know if it's near Kingston. It's near Chappaqua, where President Clinton lives.
Okay.
And it's a very nice area, but it's like Hollywood East. We've got a lot of directors and stars up there who are actually very supportive of this project. So while while Best Movies by Far really recognizes the fact that people are going to be watching more movies how they want to watch it, and if they want to stay in and watch it at home, they're going to be able to do it because they've got the beautiful flat screen, they're able to stream, it's all very convenient and easy, that there still is a place for exhibition, for the communal aspect of going to the movies, but I got to tell you, the for-profit chains, unless they wake up, they're going to have a tough time of it.
Yeah.
Because they need to focus on delivering an experience that's more than just what's up on the screen, that's about, everything else. And a lot of these cineplexes or multiplexes are downright depressing.
Yeah, I agree wholeheartedly. Let me just ask a final question in this segment. I know when I was a child and I would turn on the Million Dollar Movie or the 4:30 movie or something, and I'd watch on screen. As a kid, I always associated the movie with the actor. It was a John Wayne movie. It was a Cagney or a Bogart movie. It was a Jimmy Stewart movie. As I got older and would watch movies, and I learned more about camera movement, or I learned more about screenplays and the little ticks and whatnot, I looked at movies more director based, and you can't mistake a Stanley Kubrick movie or an Orson Welles movie for just some hack director who's just thrown into a project. How, from say your youth when you first watched movies to your middle age, as you've now become more involved in the movie business, how have you had a similar evolution as how you viewed the art of cinema?
Well, you know, to me, it's a case by case examination, and to your point. You know, if it is a big movie star, you know, if it's a Bogart or a Nicholson, you know, you're going to say it's a Jack Nicholson movie. I just saw that new Jack Nicholson movie.
Unless it's The Shining, then that's a Kubrick movie. I mean, let's face it.
Well, you're exactly right. You're right. Yeah. So it depends on whether a film is more the work of an auteur like Kubrick, or whether it's a more popular film that's driven by the star power in the film.
Yeah.
So you're right. Like Strange Trade, nobody's going to say, oh, I just saw that Farley Granger movie.
Yeah.
You know, you're not going to say that.
Yeah.
It's Hitchcock. Yeah. And you're right. La Dolce Vita, you don't say, oh, yeah, it's a great Marcello Mastroianni picture. You say it's a Fellini movie.
Yeah.
So that, but when I think of The Searchers, well, it's funny that you mentioned that, because you could go either way on The Searchers. You could say that's a John Wayne movie. You could say it's a John Ford movie. It varies. But you mentioned the auteur theory before.
Yeah.
And it's absolutely true. There are movies that are very much paying off that theory, that are driven by the directors. So you think of it as that director's film. But there are also a lot of more, usually more popular films where it is about the star power. And a lot of those Hollywood movies are that way from the old Hollywood, because it wasn't an auteur culture. The directors were journeymen. They were working for studios. They did what was asked of them, much like the actors. Although, you know, you do know, I know, you know, there's Howard Hawks and there's William Wyler and, you know, there's John Ford, and John Huston, and some of them are known for certain things or certain style, and where they could do, and have George Cukor, a lot of variety. That's a very way of saying it depends.
Okay, well, let's wrap up this segment, and when we get back, we'll just wrap up the whole interview, give you a few closing remarks, and talk about what you have planned coming up in the future. All right, John, let's wrap up this interview, and let's just talk, let you have the final closing remarks on whatever you want, whether it's about Bogart or about films in general. So go ahead, John.
Well, we've been talking about best movies by far a little bit and what it is and what it does. But behind it all is something that I think is really important, which is, you know, I really want the people who love movies to see great movies. And I think too often the way Hollywood works today, and even the way, you know, technology works, a lot of people end up seeing stuff that isn't very good, that's pushed at them. And so I encourage people to aim higher and to ask for more from their movies, from the movies that they watch. And that's why Best Movies by Far is around. It's designed to do exactly that, because the feeling that you have when you see a really great film is completely different from the feeling you have when you see an average one, where you kind of have that little nagging feeling inside that you kind of wasted your time a little bit. When you see a great movie and you say to yourself, I'm going to be thinking about that for a long time, and I don't think I'm going to forget that for a long time. That's a different experience, and that's the kind of experience that I want more people to have, because I think that movies are frankly on the wane right now. I think TV is paid cable television is having a golden age. We all know, we've heard that. House of Cards, Mad Men, all this sort of thing. But at the end, that's TV. That's very good TV, but it's episodic TV. And I love the two-hour feature film format. The ability to tell a story in under 2 hours that leaves you moved. and that uplifts you in some way, that makes you feel and that makes you think. Those movies are out there, old and new, domestic and foreign, narrative and documentary, but they're not as easy to find as they should be. But I encourage you all, whether you use Best Movies by Far or not, to just try to always go for the best, because you deserve it.
Yeah, and you know, I just want to end on that note. You know, the other day, I was thinking, you know, when films or any art tries, at least, even if they don't succeed fully, to engage the better angels of one's nature, you're always left with something that can stick in mind. I saw the last 15 or 20 minutes about a week or so ago of, I think it was the old film 310 to Yuma with Glenn Ford and who is the great
Van Heflin,
yeah, right, from Shane, and yes. And it was it was just, even in those last 15 or 20 minutes, and I hadn't seen the whole full film for many years, you get a sense that that these were artisans, these were the craftsmen who were doing something out of pleasure to give something back to people. It wasn't just about the money. I mean, yes, obviously even old Hollywood is about the money, but anyway, I agree totally with your opinions on that. And anyone who enjoyed this interview with John Farr talking about the past, come back next week, and we're going to be talking a little bit about the future. I have two young female musicians who are going to be releasing a CD, and we're going to be talking about their careers to come. But John Farr, I wanted to thank you for spending the last hour and a half or more talking about Humphrey Bogart and the classic Hollywood era. And again, for those people who want to find out more about it, you can look below this video at the link, but it's Best Movies by Farr, that's two R's, FARR.com. And John Farr, again, thank you for your time.
Thank you, Dan. I enjoyed it.
Okay. Goodbye.